54,968. They are standing. The Brewers are just one out away from winning the American League Championship Series over the Angels. Vlad ready. The 1-2 pitch. Ball lined to Yount. It's short. He throws. It's over. The Brewers have won the American League pennant. Milwaukee, you have a World Series.
Again, everybody, this is Bob Uecker, and this is the story of the 1982 Milwaukee Brewers, the year the team of the 80s became the American League champions.
Memories of the 1982 Milwaukee Brewers is presented by Miller Lite, an official sponsor of the Milwaukee Brewers. When it's Miller Lite, less filling, tastes great.
The Milwaukee Brewers began the 1982 season with high hopes, and right from opening day, the fans came in record numbers to enjoy the fun both inside the stadium and out. 1981 had given birth to the Brewers' first postseason appearance, so Brewer fans were happy to be part of what was to become the most successful season in Milwaukee Brewer history. In a way, it could be said that the Brewers' season actually began in Seattle on June 2nd. That was the day Harvey Keene took over as manager, and the born-again Brewers were christened with a new name and a new spirit that would eventually take them to the promised land. In the beginning, the Brewers had struggled, but under Keene, they flourished. And in Harvey's first game, Cecil Cooper showed his new manager something he could expect to see all season long. Right off the bat, the Brewers responded positively to Keene, especially Mike Caldwell, who won on Harvey's debut and then kept on winning 14 more times to finish the season at 17-13 after starting the year slowly with only two wins out of his first six decisions. Early in the season, the Brewer bats had been in a deep freeze, but with Keene around, things began to heat up. All it took was for someone to press the right button, and presto, the Brewers got the power. The Brewers had the power all right, all season long. In fact, they hit more home runs than any team since 1964, and that included one 15-game stretch in which they hit an American League record 35 home runs. 16 times they hit back-to-back homers, and three times they hit back-to-back-to-back home runs. Individually, three Brewers hit 30 or more home runs, led by Gorman Thomas, who tied for the league lead with 39. Under Keene, the powerful Brewers took off to their best record ever for the month of June. No doubt about it, Harvey's wall bangers were aptly named, and they were well aware of who deserved much of the credit.
As soon as Harvey took over, we kind of relaxed, and all of a sudden, we had five, six, seven guys hitting the ball well, and then all of a sudden, we just kind of got in the streak and started playing good baseball.
We're very loose, we're enjoying ourselves, and we're playing hard, smart baseball, and I think that's the reason for our winning right now. Another reason for the Brewers winning was Robin Yount, the American League's most valuable player and Sporting News Player of the Year.
I feel an offensive type shortstop. My defense has gotten better over the last few years. I'm more consistent than I have been in the past, and I still feel that my strengths, though, are my offensive capabilities.
Actually, Robin was more than capable offensively. In fact, the boy wonder even impressed his elders by becoming the first shortstop ever to lead the American League in slugging percentage and total bases.
Rob Yount is one of those fellows that you could say is an untouchable. He's an excellent base runner, excellent shortstop, excellent offensive player. He's one of the fellows that would hurt us very much if we lost him.
In 1982, Robin established himself as baseball's premier shortstop by leading the league in hits and winning a Gold Glove.
Robin's key, very key, a number two slot. He's a complete all-around ball player, perhaps the best in the game today.
I think he has all the tools to be one of the best players in all of baseball, and possibly of all time.
By mid-July, Robin was already on his way towards having a season to remember. And as a result, he was named to the All-Star team, one of four Brewers who fulfilled the ultimate fantasy. The last time Raleigh Fingers took part in fantasy, he was on his way towards winning both the Cy Young and MVP awards in 1981. And for most of the 1982 season, Fingers gave the Brewers a repeat performance. By the end of August, Raleigh had already accumulated 29 saves and seemed to be on his way towards winning his fifth Relief Man of the Year award. But on September 3rd, Fingers injured his arm and didn't throw another pitch for the rest of the season. The Brewers might have been someone who could throw like Fingers, but it was a lot easier to come up with someone who looked like him. There's no question that the 1982 was, but almost no one had more to do with their march to the World Series than a pitcher, Pete Vukovich. In 1982, Vukovich became the Brewers' second consecutive Cy Young Award winner, mainly because of an 18-6 record that included 8-game winning streaks. But even Vukovich will tell you he couldn't have done it without a little help from his friends.
Defense, and you have a lot of power outputs, scoring runs. Any other consistent pitching is going to win a lot of games, and I've been fortunate enough to have a lot of luck as possible to have these
teammates like Jim Slayton, who pitched effectively in long and short relief and as an occasional starter throughout the year. In 1982, Slayton won 10 games for the Brewers, but even more importantly, helped out in the bullpen when Raleigh Fingers was lost for the year. There were other helpful crowd pleasers too, like Jim Peter, whose offensive season as a Brewer even included a week in July as the league's leading hitter. In 1982, Gantner also played a major role in an inspired Brewer defense. And fortunately for the Brewers, even when Gantner missed nearly 30 games with assorted injuries, there was someone to step right in. With Ed Romero at second, the Brewers didn't lose a thing, and eventually wound up leading the American League in double plays for the second consecutive year. With everyone a helping hand, the Brewers fought their way to the top of the American League East. Down the stretch, the Baltimore began to apply some pressure, but the Brewers still had the right attitude.
I think the fellas have to go out and have some fun, be relaxed, and go out and play.
We know we've got a good, solid ball club, and we're just taking them one game at a time, and kind of
standing ground.
The Brewers kept on winning all right, but it wasn't easy. As it turned out, things didn't get any easier for the Brewers when they traveled to Boston for the season's final road trip. And the reason was the Orioles, who had just narrowed the once comfortable Brewer lead to two games with seven to play. In the series' first game, Ted Simmons helped narrow the Brewers' magic number to four as one of his 23 home runs on the year helped beat the Red Sox 7-3. The following night, the Red Sox got their first look at Don Sutton in a Brewer uniform, and Sutton made sure they didn't like what they saw. When the Brewers acquired Sutton on August 30th, they did so with games like this in mind, and Sutton responded by keeping the score tied at 3 until the top of the ninth, when Ned Yost delivered a clutch 3-run homer in his only at-bat against the Red Sox all season long. Yost's home run was symbolic of the trust and faith the Brewers put in their men in waiting throughout the year, and with good reason. Whenever players like Yost and Romero were on, they seemed to come through. Like Brewer, who pitched in with his 12th win of the year as the Brewers beat the Red Sox 6-3. Magic number was now down to two, and all the Brewers had to do was win one out of four games against the Orioles in Baltimore. But the Brewers and won the first three games of the series to set the stage for Don Sutton to pitch the final game of the year.
Well, what I have to do is to give our club a chance to not have to score 8 or 9 runs to win. I think that if I can shut them down early in the ball game and give us a shot to get on the board, because I see my role with this ball club as a starting pitcher as to give the offense a chance to do what they do best.
So with the division title hanging in the balance, the Brewers and Orioles prepared for the most important game of the year.
It's hard to imagine 162 games coming down one game, but we'll give it our best shot and have to deal with the results, whatever they be.
Whatever the results were going to be, the Brewers didn't take long to get going. In the top of the first, Robin Yount hit the first of his two home runs on the day to give the Brewers a quick 1-0 lead. The Brewers were on their way to ruining Earl Weaver's farewell in an Oriole uniform. But as far as they were concerned, there wasn't much sympathy. After all, the Brewers weren't about to let anything get in the way of their first ever Eastern Division title. By the top of the eighth, the Orioles were thinking about surrendering, especially when Cecil Cooper hit his 32nd home run of the year to give the Brewers a 5-1 lead. Despite their elation, the Brewers were still six outs away from the pennant. And in the bottom of the eighth, the Orioles narrowed the lead to 5-2 and made a bid to tie the game. But Ben Oglebay's great sliding catch stopped a rally. All that remained was one last out, and the Orioles were finished for 1982.
The sign from Simmons. And the two-strike pitch is hit in the air to left. Ben Oglebay coming on. He's waiting. He's waiting. He's got it. And the Brewers win the Eastern Division Championship and a very, very happy Brewer Club. The final, Milwaukee 10, Baltimore 2, and California, here they come. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. The Brewers had won the East. Just when everything seemed to be against them, they came through. Although some knew they would all along.
We knew that we had our work cut out for us today, but the guys were nice and loose when they came to the ballpark today. And when they walked out on the field, I said those fellas are ready again. And they've bounced back before, and I knew they'd bounce back again today.
Probably the biggest play of the day was the catch Benji made in the corner, which was an outstanding catch.
We have faced adversity well all year long. Resiliency has been a strong character of our club. It just shows that the Brewer House is made of stone. I said it before, and they huffed and they puffed, and they just couldn't blow us down.
Cecil made some great plays.
It was just a great win for all of us. Everybody contributed today. We had some great defensive play.
Charlie threw a guy out at the plate. Ted Simmons stuck down all the right fingers. And we beat him for the money. Now it's time to go out and do our job against California.
When the sun had finally set over Anaheim after the first two games of the American League Championship Series, the Brewers found themselves up against the wall again, just one game away from elimination. So the Brewers returned to Milwaukee, needing to sweep three games from the Angels to keep their World Series hopes alive. Playing before the home crowd was bound to help. Still, the Brewers decided a little divine intervention wouldn't hurt either, considering the opponent. Once again, Don Sutton was called on to do his thing, and do his thing he did. Sutton kept the game scoreless until the fourth, when Cecil Cooper doubled home Robin Yount with the first run of the afternoon. The Brewers scored two more times in the fourth. Then, Paul Molitor delivered what turned out to be the winning run with a two-run homer as Milwaukee built a 5-0 advantage. The Angels scored three times in the eighth to pull to within two runs, but the Brewers' defense held on, and the Brewers won Game 3, 5-3. The next afternoon, Moose Haw started for the first time in 4 weeks, and started out by holding the Angels without a hit for the first four innings. Meanwhile, the Brewer bats were red hot, and when Jim Gattner singled home Mark Brohard in the bottom of the fourth, the Brewers had a 6-0 lead. But in the top of the eighth, Don Baylor's grand slam cut the Brewer lead to two and set the stage for Mark Brohard. And Brohard responded with his third hit of the game, a two-run homer that secured the Brewers' 9-5 win and tied the series at two games apiece. Once again, the Brewers' season had come down to a single game. And this time, everything seemed to be pointing in the direction of a Brewer victory. After all, Pete Vukovich was on the mound, and he had been the Brewers' most effective pitcher all season long. Despite Vukovich's pitching, the Angels took a 3-1 lead until Ben Oglebay batted in the fourth. Oglebay's home run cut the Angel lead to one, and the Brewers were on their way. One inning later, another great throw by Charlie Moore kept the Angels from running away with the game. In the bottom of the seventh, the Brewers still trailed by a run when Cecil Cooper came to bat with two out and the bases loaded. Cooper's game-winning line drive to left stayed down as two runs scored and the Brewers went on top 4-3. In the top of the eighth, Marshall Edwards went as far as he could go to help keep the lead. And one inning later, the Brewers were on the threshold of the American League title.
Vlad ready. The 1-2 pitch, ball line to Yount, it's short. He throws, it's over. The Brewers have won the American League pennant. They have defeated the California Angels 3-2.
The Brewers were going to the series as the first team ever to win a championship series after losing the first two games.
We showed what kind of team we have here. We come back and won three in a row, and California's going to have a little longer trip home.
We go out and play our brand of ball, and we showed them that for the first time in American League history that we could sweep three straight, and we did it from a great ball club, the California Angels.
And it's the confidence and the looseness and the character of this ball club that just keeps coming through and through and through.
The first step was to beat Baltimore and win the East, and the next step is to play five or whatever it took to win this one, and now we're going to get some icing.
The icing came in the form of the World Series party to which the Brewers brought the records. Paul Molitor became the first player ever to get five hits in a World Series game. While Robin Yount also set a record by becoming the only player ever to have 2 4-hit games in a series. But Molitor and Yount weren't the only Brewers to make Milwaukee proud. There was Mike Caldwell, who won 2 series games, including a 10-0 whitewash in Game 1. And Ted Simmons, who hit 2 home runs against his ex-teammates. In the end, the final victory went to the Cardinals, but the Brewers still had plenty to celebrate in a nip-and-tuck series that went a full 7 games.
And your laughter, too, we gon' celebrate.
'82 was a great year for the Brewers, a year to be proud of. Under Harvey Keene, the Brewers battled to the best record in baseball on the strength of a powerful lineup that broke a variety of existing offensive records, even some that had stood for nearly 30 years. But more important than that, the Brewers came through with their backs to the wall time after time and earned themselves a place in their first World Series ever, making 1982 certainly a year to celebrate.
Let's celebrate. We're gonna have a good time tonight. Let's celebrate. It's all right. We're gonna have a good time tonight. Let's celebrate. It's all right, baby. We're gonna have a good time tonight. Let's celebrate.
I think I can speak for the entire team and say that we really appreciate your support this year. And come 1983, we're going to have a championship in Milwaukee.
And next year, I hope to bring the people of Milwaukee, not me, but the Milwaukee Brewers, a world championship. Thank you.